Well, good evening, everyone, just if you're gathering in. And I know it's not in our Presbyterian DNA to sit towards the front, but I am very grateful to you for your willingness. It certainly, and to be serious, it makes a preacher's life much easier to look down and see people in front of him rather than see empty pews and people far away. So thank you for that. We're going to be thinking tonight about refocusing our vision, and particularly, obviously, focusing upon God. The psalmist says, I lift up my eyes to you whose throne is in heaven. Let's praise God in the words of the hymn for, which is appropriate for New Year, I do not know what lies ahead, the way I cannot see, I know who holds the future. Let's praise God together. Let us join together in prayer. Let us pray. Our God and Father, we are your children and your humble servants, and we look to you and come to you this evening in need of hope, especially at the outset of a new year. Because, Lord, we confess that often we do feel utterly weak and helpless, confronted by tough choices and testing situations. And we pray and hope for a better future and hope for a better life, looking to you as the one who holds the future in whom is found real and abundant life. Lord, may we hear you saying to us, I am your hope. And hear your still small voice above all the other voices that clamor for our attention in today's world. Your word declares you to be hope for the hopeless. And so we turn to you, O God, with hands stretched out, grabbing hold of you as our refuge and strength. Fill us, we pray, with calming hope, with tangible reminders that that hope is an unbreakable spiritual lifeline, an anchor for the soul, firm and secure in the midst of life's storms. Lord, it's often said that the sky is at its darkest just before the light breaks through. And Lord, we pray that that may be true for us when all in these days seems dark and dismal. We look to you for the light that you can give us. We pray that we may be filled with the light of your love, basking in its glory. May our actions and attitude be rooted in your love and shielded by your grace and strength. And help us, we pray, to walk in the light of your truth and live out our life in faith and hope, guided always by your word and relying upon your gentle grace and sustaining strength. May your will and your unbreakable promises always be the meditation of our hearts and minds, that we may be filled with peace. As we were thinking this morning, we may know perfect peace and rest, confident that even if we were to take a wrong turn, your purposes, O God, will still prevail. Indeed, we trust in you alone because we know that your endless mercy will follow us and your goodness will lead us home. We commit to you, O God, our plans in our church and work and family life for the coming year. Order and direct our ways that we may seek to live for your glory. And we pray for every family connected to our congregation that your love may reach into the hearts of all, from the very youngest member to the most elderly, and your presence go with them. We pray for unity, that there may be love shared amongst us, that we may rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. And we pray tonight that you would comfort all who are sick and sorrowing. Heal those wounded in spirit. Draw back to yourself those who have drifted and gone astray. And strengthen all who are working for your glory and the growth of your kingdom. Indeed, Lord, we pray that this year may be marked by a spiritual awakening, Lord. Take us out of our lethargy and fill us afresh to lead lives that are holy and dedicated to your great commission. And all these things we ask for the sake of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. And we're going to sing together those words that I used in the hymn, your endless mercy follows me and your goodness will lead me home, as we sing together Stuart Townend's setting of the 23rd Psalm, the Lord's my shepherd and I will trust in you alone. Thank you. do make sure that if you haven't done so, that you either give your name to someone or fill out one of the track and trace forms. We trust they won't be needed, but it's important just to do that, particularly in these times that we're going through. Just one announcement, that is to say that God willing, I'll be taking the service next Sunday morning, both in Moygashel here and in the town. Just to thank Gareth for looking after things tonight, and appreciate that. Let's read together the Word of God. We turn to Matthew chapter 9. If you've got a Bible, you might want to turn to it. It's up on the screen. And we're just going to read the closing verses of that chapter. Matthew chapter 9 from verse 35. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." And it's not coincidental that following on from that, we have Jesus sending out the 12 to go and to drive out evil spirits and heal sickness and so on, and to go to the towns of the area. We're going to sing as we come to look at God's word, a lovely piece that just reminds us, we read about Jesus being filled with compassion when he saw the crowds. And here we sing, filled with compassion for all creation, Jesus came into a world that was lost. Thank you. Let's pray together. Father, we're going to be thinking tonight about our visionary focus, and we do pray that you would open our eyes because we want to see Jesus. We want to see him and say that we love him. And open our ears, Lord, now, and help us to listen, to hear you speak to us through your word. Open our eyes, Lord, we want to see Jesus. Amen. I wonder, can you identify with that picture? I think I'm kind of airing all my ailments at the moment. I was saying at the New Year's Eve service that, you know, about increasingly with age, the grey matter gets less, the eyesight doesn't get any better either, and we all struggle, don't we, in one sense. And, you know, lack of clear vision is a great handicap, isn't it? A great handicap. And, you know, it's exactly the same in life, isn't it? Do we have a vision in terms of our goals, what we intend to do, what we hope for? And sometimes our vision can be somewhat limited. And it's exactly the same in spiritual terms. You know, we begin a new year with all kinds of ambitions, and even when it comes to spiritual matters, our vision for God and our vision of God can easily become somewhat blurred, and we lose our focus. And it's good that we take the opportunity, as it were, to refocus at the beginning of a new year. So in what way can our vision get out of focus? Well, we can become somewhat short-sighted, can't we, in life? Where we live for the day and we don't live for the destiny. When we give no thought to the future, and particularly in terms of eternity. And that's so typical of many people. I wonder, is it of you? That we are short-sighted and we think only of the things of this world, and the farthest end of all our thoughts is the thought of our end. We give little of any consideration to the future and what lies beyond in terms of eternity to come. Now, that's not something new. Sinful human nature from the very beginning has always taken a somewhat short-sighted view of things. We can go right back to the beginning, to the Garden of Eden, where we're told when the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food, she took some and ate it, giving no thought to the consequences of her actions. It was short-sighted, wasn't it? Adam and Eve had been clearly told what would happen, but they ignored that and took a short-sighted view. Or what about Lot, with his uncle Abraham looking out over the valley below, and Lot chose the fertile land, but gave no thought to the evil of the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. A short-sighted view. And then, of course, we have Jesus' parable of the farmer who had the bumper harvest, thought he had it made, build bigger barns, and gave no thought to his life's end. This very night, you fool, this very night, your soul will be required of you. What then will become of your riches? We take a short-sighted view, don't we? We're caught up with this world and we don't look beyond it. But any outlook on life that deals only with the here and now is wholly inadequate. If we have no vision of eternity, then we will never get a true hold of time here and now. If we're caught up with this world, then we are certainly not ready for the next, for heaven. Everlasting life is too precious to be thrown away for that which doesn't last, for that which is only temporary. That's why the American revivalist preacher of the 18th century, Jonathan Edwards, prayed, "Lord, stamp eternity on my eyeballs." Give us a vision. Make us not short-sighted. Help us to turn away from that which doesn't last. And focus. Focus. That's what we have to do. Focus upon what matters. Focus upon that which does last. Upon our enduring treasures held in heaven. That inheritance which is incorruptible and undefiled. Kept for us. We need to focus and get our vision right and not be short-sighted. But remember, as Paul puts it in Philippians 3, that our citizenship is in heaven. And we need to take that long view. Let's not be short-sighted. But you know, we can fall into the opposite trap, can't we? And we can be just long-sighted. And everything gets out of perspective. Now, don't get me wrong. We've been reflecting upon how our citizenship is in heaven, and we must have a long-term, eternal perspective. But we mustn't make the mistake, as so many do, of being so heavenly-minded that we're actually of no earthly use for our Master here and now. You know, that even applies to the activities of church. We can be so busy in church activities that we actually don't see the needs of people around us. Their spiritual and their material needs. We are long-sighted and we don't see what is near to hand, what is around us. Now, don't get me wrong, there are, of course, times when we need, particularly in difficulty and distress, to turn our eyes upon Jesus and allow the things of earth to grow strangely dim in the light of God's glory and grace. We must do that and set things in their eternal perspective as we've seen. And focus upon God, His glory, His presence that will form our destiny. But we mustn't do that at the expense of losing vision for a needy, lost world that is without God and without hope. Do we have a passion for souls? Do we have a vision? Jesus said, "Open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest." Are we so caught up with the eternal that we don't actually see the needs around us, the harvest field that is there? We need to catch the right vision. We're warned in the book of Proverbs, where there is no vision, the people perish. And if we lack a vision for those around us, there will be those who perish. I'm always challenged by the prophet Ezekiel's use of the image of the watchman. I'm not sure what the modern equivalent would be, probably a soldier on duty outside, say, Buckingham Palace. But they're there, not just for ceremonial, but in Bible times, they were there because there was danger. And the watchman would have to go up under the city walls and sound the trumpet to warn the people of what lay ahead, of the danger that was coming. And if they failed to give the warning, they would be held accountable. And what Ezekiel was saying is, look, you are to be a watchman and warn the people of what lies ahead. And we are called and will be held accountable if we fail to sound the warning, to share the gospel hope of heaven to be gained, but also the reality of hell to be avoided. Let's not be short-sighted, but make sure that we take the long-term view and see things in the light of eternity and heaven to come. But at the same time, let's not be long-sighted and of no earthly use and miss out on the needs around us. In other words, let's get a balanced vision. What is it? Perfect vision, 2020 vision. That is depth and clarity. So that we neither lose sight of future glory to come, nor of the present needs of people around us. But for that to happen, we need to live a consistent and obedient Christian life in accordance with God's word. I think that's what Jesus meant when in the Beatitudes he said, blessed are they pure in heart, for they shall see God. If we want to have the right vision, then we need to have a pure heart and live as God desires us to live. And more than that, we should learn to look at the world through the eyes of our Savior. Jesus always saw people, and he saw their needs, whether those needs were spiritual or physical, and he sought to meet people at their point of need. It's not what we read about. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. As we sang, Jesus was filled with compassion. Do you remember when he healed the leper? We're told filled with compassion, Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. Or what about the widow of Nain who had lost her son? When the Lord saw her, his heart went out to her, we're told. Or Mary, along with her sister Martha, on the death of their brother Lazarus. When Jesus saw Mary weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. The Lord Jesus is not merely the Son of God, mighty to save. He is the Son of Man who is able to feel, who cares. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses. We were thinking this morning about, learning. Learn from me, Jesus said. And to be Christ-like, we need to have that compassion that he had. Our Lord's whole life was full of humility and thoughtfulness and kindness and love. And so we need to refocus. We need to get things in their right perspective. We need to have a balanced vision. And we need to have eyes so that we can truly see where our future destiny is, but also see the needs of those around us. And refocus, particularly in terms of evangelism and sharing the good news of the gospel. Jesus always saw the value of all whom he met. and he cared for them enough to speak the truth to them. Do we? In the early 1920s, the then president of the Coca-Cola company issued a company vision. And that vision was that no person on the face of the earth would die without tasting Coca-Cola. Some vision. I wonder, do we have a vision that no person on earth will perish without having had the opportunity to taste and see that the Lord is good? To reach out to people. That's what we need to do, to refocus our vision, to reach out to an increasingly godless, a materialistic and secular world, and share the good news of Jesus Christ. We need to have that clear vision that gets the future and the present into right perspective, that is balanced. And we need to keep looking to Jesus and focusing and refocusing always upon him. Do you remember when Jesus came out to meet the disciples walking on the water? Typical of Peter, of course, he had to get out. He had to have a go himself. And he was able to walk on the water so long as he was focused upon Christ. As long as he kept Jesus in his eye line. But when he took his eyes off Jesus, that's when he began to flounder. When he saw the wind and the waves and didn't see Christ. That's when he faltered. We need to make sure as we enter into this new year that Jesus Christ is indeed at the very center of everything that we do and focus our vision upon him. In all your ways, acknowledge him and he will direct your paths. Make your path straight. Let's pray together. Father, we confess that often we get things out of perspective. We cannot see around us because we're so caught up with the hereafter. Or we're not even giving any thought to what is to come. Lord, help us to refocus and get balanced vision. To set our goal as heavenwards. To look to Jesus and have Christ-like eyes that see people and see their needs around us. And help us indeed to in every way acknowledge you as our God and Savior, knowing that you will direct us and make our paths straight throughout this new year and into the future. Amen. Our closing hymn just takes up that thought of focusing upon Jesus. O soul, are you weary and troubled? Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Thank you. grace, mercy and peace from God the Father, Son and Holy Spirit be with us and all whom we love this night and forevermore.